Hello, everyone. Good morning or good afternoon. Buen dia. Bienvenidos. I'm so pleased you're all here. I've been looking forward to this conversation for a long time, so I'm happy it's happening today. It will occur simultaneously in English and Spanish, so feel free to select the language you would like to use by clicking the globe icon at the bottom of your Zoom screen. And if you prefer to hear the interpreters only without the speaker's voice in the background, please select mute original audio. And thanks to Camila Lagos and Florencia Solotay for helping with the interpretation. We couldn't do this without you. So this is the third and final part of a series that is focused on innovating protection for children on the move across the Americas. Throughout, we have aimed to bring a child-focused and solutions-oriented lens to the dynamic and difficult landscape of migration between countries of origin and return, at the U.S.-Mexico border, and within receiving communities across the United States. The number of young people fleeing high levels of violence, crime, natural disasters, food insecurity, and poverty, and crossing the U.S.-Mexico border reached a 20-year high in fiscal year 2021. And this included a record number of children who crossed the border unaccompanied. Once they get here, many newly arriving migrant and asylum-seeking children arrive to the home of a parent or a relative in the US after years of separation. Some have lived with a great deal of independence, taking care of their own survival under extraordinary circumstances. Most need significant support upon their release from federal custody and as they navigate their new lives in the United States. So communities across the country are truly challenged to meet their needs, and often they receive very little in the way of federal or state support. So our conversation today is going to consider the needs of migrant and asylum-seeking children and youth in the United States and the efforts that are underway to help them find protection and stabilities in their new communities. We're going to learn a little bit more today about who is responsible for providing the support and who's innovating to make sure that it happens. So I'm grateful to our conversation partners today, each a key player and innovator in this challenging work. Welcome to Kathleen Goss, Matt Haygood, Verena Knaus, Juanita Cabrera-Lopez, Wendy Miron, and Diego Uriburu. I would also like to welcome Luis Alberto Garcia, who's our graphic facilitator and will be breaking up the regular flow of webinars with some drawings and cartoons. So I hope you'll appreciate that and it will help keep your spirit young. I'm Gillian Huebner, and I'm pleased to be leading a recently launched initiative at Georgetown, the Collaborative on Global Children's Issues. And as a collaborative, we don't do anything alone. This forum is a joint effort between partners who have committed to working together to ensure that our conversations are inclusive of a variety of perspectives, including especially those of young people, and also community and international organizations, policymakers, researchers, and other stakeholders. Our collaborative design team for this forum includes UNICEF, the Global Fund for Children and its network of local civil society organizations on both sides of the border, and two youth-serving organizations in the DC metro area, Identity and Imagination Stage. And at Georgetown, we're doing this together with the Americas Institute and the Institute for the Study of International Migration, and also with support from the Office of the Vice President for Global Engagement. Today's conversation, and in fact, the whole forum, is also taking place on an online platform. We will share a link to our blog series in the chat, and we are grateful to all who have shared their insights. It has been a real collage of experiences and perspectives, so I hope you will take a look. It's a great mosaic. This webinar is being recorded, and the video will be posted to the event page on our website soon. And if you've registered for today's event, you will receive an email with the video when it becomes available. And we'll save some time for questions at the end of our conversation. So please feel free to join along the way using the Q&A box at the bottom of your Zoom screen and typing your question. So we're going to begin and end this session with the true experts. And these are the young people who have made the migration journey themselves. More than anyone, they know what they need to feel safe along the way and as they navigate their new lives in the US. So to help us do this, we're going to start with a video clip from a play that was produced by a local theater group, Imagination Stage, which has also been part of our collaborative design team. This play actually began as a small after-school program, providing a space for newcomer youth to explore their stories and share their experiences in a culturally sensitive and trauma-informed way. Over time, the students helped playwright Miriam Gonzalez create the play, which follows a group of teens from Central America, making the dangerous trek across the border to the Washington, D.C. region. And in this scene, which we'll play right now, these young migrants reflect on what it feels like to arrive in the United States.
America.
11.
13.
9.
10 or more.
Years.
Since we'd seen our mothers.
My mother, waiting for me over here. Mi papi, taken from me over there. Desaparecido. Taken, gone. So I run.
To America.
To our tío y tía.
To our papi's brother and his wife. Yo tenía dos años cuando mi madre se fue. For years we talked on the phone.
Minutos here, minutos there.
A voice. La voz de mi mami. I only imagine how her hair
might feel the day I could see her. Hold her.
And then?
We stepped. I stepped.
Llegamos en
America.
It was the happiest day. El día más feliz de mi vida. But also the saddest.
Maybe even the maddest.
I thought I'd see pretty parks, pink trees, ladies dressed in white.
Big cities, tall towers, white cars and bright lights.
Nah, only detention buildings. More days.
Floating, not knowing, in the middle. Stuck. And then a plane.
100 airports. We ate pollo a Chick-fil-A. Then the day, el día llegó, it came. First time I saw her eyes, heard her say my name.
We don't know you.
We only seen your pictures, we told our tío, we told his wife. It was a hot day. Mi mami's hair, a long braid, una trenza, black shorts. I thought I heard her say,
you look like him, your papi. No, I look like you, mi mami.
I cried. So happy.
So confused.
Reunidos. En los Estados Unidos.
Reunited.
In the United States.
Are you proud of me? Will you love me?
Do you miss him? Never leave me.
Who are you? ¿Quién eres? You will never know me.
I know you.
13.
14.
15.
13.
Years old.
Teenagers.
Adolescentes.
In America.
Thank you to Imagination Stage and to the young people who shared those stories through their clip. In good news, actually, Imagination Stage and some of those actors will be on campus at Georgetown this weekend on Saturday, doing a related piece of work related to that. And we will share in the chat information about that. It's an open event and we hope you can attend if you are local. Okay, so let's begin this conversation with our innovators. Wendy Miron is the Senior Director of Social Services with Kids in Need of Defense, also known as KIND. And KIND supports children on the move at all stages of the journey, from the countries of origin, along the migration corridor, at the border, and in US communities. And you specifically work to ensure trauma-informed programming all across your field offices and in the US and in Northern Mexico. So after these young children are released from federal custody and they come into the care of a sponsor, what do they need to help them integrate into their new lives and communities? And in the midst of these challenges, which they face, which are enormous, what do you see that's working?
Thank you so much, Jillian, and everybody else on this panel, as well as Georgetown University's Collaborative on Global Children's Issues. I am so delighted to be here today and Also, thank you for everybody who's taking time. I know how busy everybody's schedule is. As Jillian mentioned, I'm Wendy Miron and I oversee social services at KIND. Mucho gusto, mi nombre es Wendy Miron. Voy a hacer la presentación en inglés, pero si tienen algunas preguntas, las pueden hacer en español y se las puedo contestar en español o en inglés. So I am a clinical social worker and I work at Kids in Need of Defense, who we really provide a wide range of platform for protecting the rights of migrant children in many diverse ways. Some of the ways that I'm gonna share examples today are not, you know, exclusive to KIND, and I cannot underscore enough how the most important part of building the coalition is really listening to the children and the youth that we serve, and also creating support systems such as this for the providers and really building the networks so that we can make sure that we're sharing best practices, that we are hearing from each other, and of course, always elevating the voices of youth. So I really appreciated the video that you just shared. So some of the examples that we have been creating at KIND could not be possible without funding support. As we know, we all have lots of different ideas and ways that we want to support young people, young children, but without financial support, it's very challenging to really make this happen. At KIND, we have been fortunate in social services to be able to have the support of funders such as Robert Johnson or the Ho Foundation, who are champions in the overall well-being of children's rights, and who have really allowed us to be creative and innovative in the way that we provide direct services to clients, in the way that we foster cross-sector coordination and technical assistance to local partners within KIND and the pro bono networks, as well as really establishing partnership development and engaging in non-legal volunteer partners so that we can support kids in a number of ways. Other partners have also included the California Department of Social Services, CDSS, as well as New Jersey's the Department of Health Services, that have allowed us to expand their social services, both through technical assistance to organizations across California, as well as being able to expand case management in New Jersey to provide migrant children and unaccompanied minors not only legal supports, but case management along their long legal cases, as many of you know. So just to share a couple of examples, I know we only have a few minutes and I can talk at length about all of the many innovative ways that social services has been able to support clients both at the U.S. Mexico northern border, as well as across our field offices. We started with three social service coordinators in 2016, providing concrete needs and referrals to clients across all of our field offices, to now soon to be a team of 40 social service coordinators that include specialized technical assistance, as well as volunteer and engagement support staff. So some of the examples include being able to partner with our policy team. It is not only necessary to be able to identify the needs and work at the local level, but their policy collaboration has really allowed us to be able to flag issues, such as being able to have a social security number that is needed in order to access healthcare, or being able to support both the works staff, especially during the height of the pandemic and as vaccinations were becoming available, to make sure that ORR was able to provide these vaccinations both for staff and also for children in shelter. Some of the other ways that I know that we're going to be sharing some of the, you know, the pamphlets and the fact sheets that we have created are the school fact sheets that really provide some information of what are the routes and what is the trajectory for unaccompanied minors in the education system, as well as some really important considerations for using the ORR verification form as one of the forms to obtain ID, either local or state IDs, which, as you know, I'm sure all of you know, it's absolutely necessary if we're gonna ensure that our, you know, our clients, our youth are able to access services. You know, one of the things that I cannot underscore enough is making sure that our practices are rooted in strengths and resilience of the children that we serve. I know that it's very difficult, as we know that so many of the kids have experienced adverse childhood experiences, you know, complex trauma, both in country of origin and route as they arrive in the US going through CBP or ORR. But it's also really important to be able to think about how do we create the systems so that they are able to really support long-lasting strengths and really overall well-being of the child, the family network, as well as the communities. And some of the ways that, you know, I really believe and I've seen the work is being able to listen to the clients, being able to listen to the local partners, and, you know, really think about the resilience that the children bring. They were able to make this journey alone. They're here, they're able to come to our offices. So really thinking about it and reframing it and reframing the conversations that we're having, I believe can really be ways that we can highlight bright spots. During the pandemic, I can't underscore how difficult it was to really be able to reach clients and children, of course, in their communities when we were in lockdown or we were really pivoting to provide services remote. But through that experience, we were able to really think creatively about how do we reach clients who are reporting increased isolation, who are not going to school, who are not able to really connect with others because everybody is at home, they might not have the technology. So we were able to identify ways to get technology to clients and really partner with other local and national organizations such as Art Illusion or Arts Cord. And we came up with some therapeutic activities, really a range of them. We had therapeutic dance workshops where children from different field offices in the East Coast were able to meet bi-weekly and have a space where they were able to create dance moves and choreography, and then they were able to showcase their work. As the pandemic has shifted and things have improved, we were able to also do this in person, and we had a mural project in New York City with the partnership of Art Illusion, which I hope that you're able to see some of the slides. It was just an amazing experience. Some other ways that we were also able to do this and really think about what are the many interventions, I don't think that there's a one size fits all, is also thinking about mental health partnerships. We know that it is extremely difficult to access mental health counseling, but also being able to help children and youth understand what is the value. I mean, I think nationally and globally, there is a stigma around mental health, wellness, and that we know that being able to access counseling is just the first step. It doesn't, healing doesn't happen immediately. So being able to have workshops such as, parent-child dyad workshops that a therapist can explain what happens in therapy? How do we support each other? I think that the play really, captured just some of the ambivalence and some of the expectations and some of the, I think the rupture and repair that needs to take place when somebody meets a caregiver or a family member after a long separation. So we have been working with play therapists in New Jersey for tender age children support, as well as we started a mental health project partnership in Seattle with a mental health counselor who we vetted as culturally responsive and able to really support some of the clients that were not able to access counseling services and were really in need of it. Some of the other really bright spots that we have been able to identify this past few years include the partnership with California Department of Social Services, as I mentioned. We are providing TA to 9 organizations as part of a project called Opportunities for Youth Project. And one of the organizations is actually the Oakland Unified School District. And last year we were able to partner with them and hosted a national convening where we really were anticipating, due to the surge of children and the, just the increase of arrivals, that schools were going to really need information about who are unaccompanied minors. What are their needs? How do we even identify them? Because as we know, unaccompanied minors is a legal term that we don't always, unless we're working with migrant children, we don't always know that a child isn't an unaccompanied minor, and they themselves do not identify as unaccompanied minors in school systems or other places. Other service providers are not really sure sometimes that the child might not have a mother. So we were able to partner, and we had a really great attendance and just providing really best practices on, how do you support young people? And again, it's not a one size fits all. Some of the other activities that I can share, and we're almost out of time, are just making sure that we're always committed to lifelong learning. It doesn't matter how long we're in this work, there's always new opportunities for learning and really I think remaining true to our cultural humility lens. And, you know, an example is with the recent Afghan arrivals at KIND, we primarily work with Spanish-speaking, Mayan-speaking children who speak K'iche, K'echi, K'achikel, but we didn't really have any children who spoke, any children from Afghanistan. So we partner with experts, you know, psychiatrists, medical experts that were able to provide training, not just to social services, but also to our legal team on cultural humility when working with Afghan children. You know, as well as we've partnered with, you know, organizations that work with indigenous communities so that we're able to not just uphold language justice, but also be able to really value the children's experiences and the youth and be able to also support their ability to feel proud about their identity and who they are. And then just lastly, very quickly, I want us to also be aware of the needs of staff doing this work. You know, as we all have experienced a pandemic, we have added, you know, personal stressors, compounded grief, and high levels of vicarious trauma that we're all carrying. That also really impacts everybody differently depending on the proximity that we have to the communities that we serve. So ensuring that we're putting together frameworks that consider staff wellness and create spaces such as reflective supervision, consultation, healthy boundary trainings, and also flexibility and opportunities to celebrate the wins, no matter how big or how small, can really support healthy work environments and also staff retention in this field. You know, there's nothing worse than somebody who is burned out, who meets with a child. You know, the most important thing for a child is having a trusted adult. And as service providers and organizations and coalitions, we can really ensure that success if we're able to support the staff that's doing the work. And I think just normalizing the importance of mental health and wellness. I'll just end with one example for one of our offices in New York who created what we call wind downs that have now been implemented across field offices. And that is just a very quick check-in at the end of, you know, regular meetings that they have. This was started with the detained team. And during the pandemic, it was so difficult to make sure that kids had the right language access, that they had the right link to the Zoom. And so a lot of times after a long legal intake day, it was just very stressful for staff because they had navigated not only very difficult, emotionally taxing conversations with young children, because we serve tender age children, but also just technology challenges where, you know, you would join a Zoom link and nobody was there. So part of the debriefings for the end of the day included, of course, you know, concrete, how do we get these links to work tomorrow? But also, let's practice a mindfulness exercise, or let's practice some type of grounding activity, or let's try to think about, you know, what resilience did we see in one of the children? And let's, you know, what is the takeaway that we can end with? And that was something that was so supportive and helpful for that team that we really started normalizing it. And I believe that most field offices have some type of wind down activity. And I feel like we're going to coin the term, but I cannot give enough credit to our social services coordinators who came up with that, you know, that idea.
That's great. I love how you started with resilience and you ended with resilience, and that's the sort of key entryway into your work in this field. Thank you so much. Luis, do you want to show us what you captured? I feel like he's a great summarizer. Can you share your screen, Luis? He's going to translate these in English when we're all done as well, for those who would like a copy in English. Again, the focus on resilience and really listening to the young people about what they need. Thank you. That's excellent. Okay, now we're going to move to Diego Uriburu, who's one of my local heroes in Montgomery County, Maryland. He's the executive director and co-founder of Identity, which is the largest Latino youth serving organization in the county, serving thousands of young people and families each year. He was also named a White House Champion of Change under Obama, and he co-founded the Black and Brown Coalition for Educational Equity and Excellence. So Diego, your organization is truly on the front lines of the response to newly arriving migrant and asylum seeking children in Montgomery County, which is, as you know, one of the top receiving areas in the country for unaccompanied migrant children released to sponsors. So to what extent are county services, including public schools, and Wendy really emphasized the importance of the working with schools on receiving these children, what extent are the county services prepared to meet the needs of newcomer youth And how do community-based organizations like yours help inform and shape that response? Thanks for being
Thank you, Gillian. Thank you. Buenas tardes. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for the question and for all your efforts, Gillian, to make this country better able to meet the needs of asylum seeking and immigrant Chilean families. So Montgomery County is a wonderful place to be. The county has been receiving immigrant youth and families and asylum seekers for many years. And it's a county that values the contributions of these communities and has been welcoming, as I said, for many years. one of the most innovating things that the county did was to learn from our mistakes. There have been surges before, and there have been surges where we were not really well prepared to meet the needs of these young people and their families. The county has both Health and Human Services, the school system, recreation, and the many nonprofits that make the safety net of the county have always worked with these communities and understand them well. But in the past, the sheer magnitude, the volume, really made it very difficult for us to do a good job. So when we, the county, realized that this wave of youth and families were coming, the first thing that we did was to sit down and ask ourselves, what can we do better this time around? And I have to say that the county has done and continues to do a phenomenal job at making these young people, the families, feel welcome, supported, their services have been met, and also help them integrate into the fabric of Montgomery County, Maryland. And how did we accomplish this? One of the key aspects of our success was the creation of an interagency steering committee. The steering committee included members of the county executive's office who would come on a weekly basis to meet with us, including a representative from the county council. The council was interested in the well-being of these young people and their families, including members of Health and Human Services, members of the school system, of the rec department, and then many other stakeholder groups like other nonprofits, etc. And the first things that this group did was to try to identify what the needs of these young people and families are. And then once we did that, we began to work with the county executive and the council to ask for additional supports, because as you well mentioned at the beginning, the state and the federal government does not provide sufficient supports. It provides very little support for these young people and families, very, very little. And when we're talking about thousands, then the situation gets quite complicated. One of the biggest opportunities that the county also seized was that we had just dealt with COVID, and the Latino community in Montgomery County was highly, highly impacted by COVID. And at one point, the county government turned around and asked the nonprofit sector to work with HHS and MCPS is the school system, sorry, to come up with a culturally and linguistic competent response. So we had that infrastructure in place. And so the steering committee began to look at the needs and basically came up with a programmatic response to the needs. The name of the program is Bienvenidos, no? That stands for welcome, which reflects the attitude of county officials and society that where this community and these young people and families are truly, truly welcomed. So what services did the county put in place? The county put $5 million to fund these efforts, more or less. And the efforts included navigation and communications. And for example, communications, the county had done a phenomenal job prior to the young people arriving and families with the pandemic. And they created a character called Abuelina. It's like an abuela, like a grandmother, that the community would listen to in terms of COVID. And it was easy to transfer that trust, no, and that character to also welcome the newly arrived young people and families. The outreach networks were already settled, and we worked with health promoters, so we could use those promoters that were deeply embedded in the affected communities where many of these young people would go live. So it was, a win-win. The county also funded legal orientation and services so that the young people that needed would get legal advice and a lawyer if they had a case that they could move forward with. Another big one was youth development and recreation. We wanted to integrate these young people very, very quickly into society. So we had sports leagues. We run activities in the schools, out of school, in order to ensure these young people are integrated within themselves, but also into the school system, which is a system that they rely heavily on. There were two big forums where hundreds and hundreds of newly arrived young people attended, and they share the stories. Young people that had come 5 years ago or 6 years ago share their stories, and these young people began to lead their own efforts to be better engaged, to feel and to support each other as they get to know the county, etc. The county continued to fund programs that they funded prior. For example, there are two programs on family reunification that are very, very important to provide support to the parents and the youth. And I would venture to say that the outcome of the reunification program really makes it or break it in terms of the well-being of the children. If reunification doesn't happen very well, then we all know that gangs are there to prey on males and females, and older men are there to prey on young girls. So the county built, it was not just what it was funded here, but it also built in its investments that were in place prior to this. Public safety and trafficking prevention had also been a key, because as we know, people take advantage of these young people. Others who see them as newcomers and might not like them, but also gangs, etc. So that was another big component. Education and school-based activities were also a key. And for each one of these areas, the steering committee had developed subcommittees that would oversee the work that was done in each one of these areas and would hold us accountable. The school had all of us had some challenges. The school had a little bit more of a challenge, but the school and HHS hired two coordinators that would coordinate the services that HHS, Health and Human Services, would be in charge of, and MCPS, school system, would be in charge of. They did a phenomenal job, and I think that they made a huge difference in the lives of these young people. So I know that time is of the essence here, but I think that Montgomery County, the fact that we knew this population well before it came, because we've been serving it for years. The fact that we were prepared and prepared the infrastructure before the numbers got too big. The fact that everyone from the county executive to the council, to HHS, to MCPS, to the nonprofits, leverage our own social networks with philanthropy and others in order to provide more services to these young people. All that made a huge difference, and you cannot account for what it means for these young people and families to come to a county that really welcomes them, that doesn't make them feel unwanted. I think that just with that, you have 50% of the battle won. The fact that you have all this coordination between many different nonprofits with different expertise, tremendous organizations like the health department and the school system, with the support and accountability from the county executive and the council, all that continues to make Montgomery County a great place for these young people and families to be. So with that,
Thank you. You were certainly, this was largely due to your leadership and your honesty in county council meetings, et cetera. I mean, I guess one of the benefits also is that, you know, you listen to the young people arriving and those with power in the county listen to you. And that makes a difference. So thank you.
Well, I just want to make sure it's a plural you. It's not just, I play a role, but many others play roles. Sure.
No, absolutely. Actually, and if you want to read more about the case of Montgomery County, we have a blog post written by the county executive and the county council president in our series online. So I think Nikki will probably put it in the chat, but feel free to read more about that. And we can connect anyone who's interested in being in touch with the county that's made that happen. Thank you. Luis, do you want to quickly share your screen again? We'll have to send this to the Montgomery County coordination team. Great. Yeah, I think that issue of welcoming, just letting these kids know early on upon their arrival that they're welcome and that they're seen and that there are services that they have the right to access is extraordinary. Thank you, Luis. Okay, moving to Juanita Cabrera Lopez, who's another hero from, well, from Guatemala, but also from Montgomery County and a national leader. She is Maya Mam, and she's the executive director of the International Mayan League, originally from the Western Highlands of Guatemala, also a survivor of internal armed conflict and a former political refugee. Juanita, many of the children who are crossing the U.S.-Mexico border, in fact, the most of them right now are from Guatemala, and many are Native American. They're not Hispanic or Latino. They speak indigenous languages, an important truth that often goes unnoticed at border facilities and in receiving communities, and certainly also in public schools. So can you speak about some of the safety and protection concerns that are unique to indigenous migrant children in the U.S. and the efforts that are currently underway to support them?
Good greetings. My name is Juanita, and I greet you from Piscataway Nation territory, also known as D.C., Maryland, and Virginia. It is a pleasure and honor for me to be here, and thank you so much for the kind invitation. I also wanted to quickly thank the entire team of the International Mayan League for working jointly on this presentation and also our article that goes into detail on the presentation. But more than that, I wanted to thank our team that has been working tirelessly to meet the needs and rights of our Indigenous families, children, and youth that are resettling, not just locally, but also at the national level. I wanted also to make clear that I'm simply a messenger this morning of some of the testimonies and information that we were able to capture in terms of the realities lived by our communities. I wanted to just make sure that there was a clear understanding about the particular experiences that Indigenous peoples have in the reasons of why we're forced to flee in the first place, our particular migration journeys, and then how these particular experiences and vulnerabilities do not stop at the border, but continue with us as we resettle and end up in our final places of destination. For Indigenous peoples, our migration has been intrinsically linked with resettlements that are tied closely to colonialism, imperialism, and forced displacement. For many of us, we characterize it as forced displacement of four eras, beginning for more than 500 years. And right now we're looking at displacement that's closely tied to the fourth level of displacement, which is connected to conflicts over our lands and territories and extractive industries and imposed development in our countries of origin. What this has done, it has had very particular effects on Indigenous peoples. And as has already been noted, Guatemala is the highest in terms of the numbers but we are an indigenous majority country. Even if it is not recognized as such, we are 22 distinct Maya nations. Within the whole Maya territory, it is 31 distinct Maya nations, means languages, cultures, cosmovisions, histories, worldviews. And part of this it's very important to recognize this when you start to respond in places of final destination. For Indigenous peoples, as we are then in the border region in our migration journey, the vulnerabilities that we face are connected with our indigeneity, racism, discrimination, and the fact that we have been miscategorized as Latino or Hispanic. And the reason why now people within the immigrant rights space are finally acknowledging Indigenous peoples is because it has been Indigenous peoples ourselves advocating for that change. That has not come from the organizations or the media. It has come from us leading that advocacy and pushing for the recognition of our peoples. What that has meant, particularly in our places of destination, and I wanted to go ahead and include some quotes here from some of the testimonies that we received. When we are in our final destination, quote, we are invisible. The greater community does not even know we exist or are here, reflects Yesenia, a former Maya mom child migrant. She adds, our own people are helping others. Miguel, who is a former unaccompanied minor of the Maya Quiche Nation, says, resettlement in the north is another world. There may be protection and resources, but inequality is still visible. My greatest protection has been arriving in a community familiar to me because my own Quiche and Ishil peoples are there fighting for their fallen brothers and sisters and justice. And lastly, I also want to say that as Miguel continues in his testimony, he says, in the United States, brothers and sisters rebuild lives and have families. Yet this often happens in secrecy. Why do we hide? Out of fear? Because we don't want our children to suffer what we have suffered. And so what those quotes clearly indicate are several factors of why our identity is a key factor of both external and internal erasure by the dominant society that does not recognize us. There are no forms that continue to recognize us. And again, because of the mislabeling of Hispanic and Latinidad over Indigenous peoples, but also the fact that internally, it has been a way to preserve us for survival. When we as Indigenous peoples have been persecuted for more than 500 years because we are Indigenous, one of the ways that we have survived is to hide our identity. So what that has meant in the counties locally within this context of PG County, Fairfax County, and Montgomery County, which are numbers 6, 10, and 12 in terms of receiving unaccompanied minors in the country, not just in the region. What this means is that it has really been Indigenous peoples responding and creating the solutions. All of us know that we have been affected by COVID and we are still in a time of COVID. But what that has meant for particularly vulnerable communities like the immigrant community or Indigenous peoples in diaspora is that we have been left out. We were left out of vaccines, we were left out of information, PPE, and emergency response. So we had to pull ourselves together from the communities, from an Indigenous response to resettlement, which is how we do our work, to make sure that information was being received in COVID in our languages, that we created an Indigenous Solidarity Fund to help meet needs and the gaps for food, for resources in our community. It meant building up our capacity to provide interpretation in our languages. So providing spaces of capacity building for Maya interpreters. But what that has also shown us is that the Maya Health Promoters model, which is the first model of its kind in the DC metropolitan region, has now opened pathways for new ways in which our community sees the Maya Health Promoters model as a place of trust, as a place of resources, where we can provide cultural and linguistic accompaniment, where it is community leaders from our own communities, where they can physically see themselves represented in the support that's coming to our communities. And so I know we're running out of time, but I just wanted to close by providing a couple of recommendations on ways that we can work together. One, of course, that has already been, I think everyone has shared, is really focusing on the needs and the rights directly from the community. What that means is working directly with the community, whether it's community leaders, community organizations, understanding that there are solutions already being created in our communities, and elevating those, supporting those community-led solutions. But because Indigenous peoples have such a very specific structural barriers to our inclusion in our communities and the reasons why we were forced out in the first place from our ancestral lands, from a policy recommendations perspective, and we've been honing on this for several years, is that we need better ways of capturing data at intake in terms of disaggregated data to acknowledge that we exist and are part of the community, because otherwise our needs and rights, including our language needs, are not met. We also want to make sure that Indigenous peoples and organizations are part of the discussions in family reunification process, in working with unaccompanied minors, with providing Indigenous language resources. And so not being an afterthought, but rather a very particular and very a part of the design in terms of the development process for strategies that are community-led, but not because those are buzzwords, but rather because they work, and because that's what's needed in order to bridge the gaps in our communities. So I will stop there and thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Thank you, Juanita. Luis, I'll invite you to share your screen. But Juanita, I remember when you made this a similar point to the county council and named the issue of erasure. And once you hear that, you notice how true it is in the school forms and whatnot, the data collected by the Office of Refugee Resettlement at the border. The fact that the majority of people in our communities don't understand what the main Mayan languages spoken in their community are, you begin to notice how nearly complete that erasure is. So thank you for waking so many people up to that. Obviously, there's no protection if we can't see those who need protecting. Thank you. I'm going to move now to Kathleen Goss, who is the Associate Director for Foster Care with the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops and their Migration and Refugee Services. So as we've talked about in the whole series of these conversations, faith actors have been providing critical supports to children on the move at all stages of their journey, starting at countries of origin. And in the United States, USCCB works with a national network of direct care providers to deliver child welfare services to newcomer youth through the Safe Passages programming. And these programs are funded, one of the programs funded by the Federal Office for Refugee Resettlement, to provide critical support to unaccompanied children specifically. How do these programs support children who've entered the country alone and prepare them to reunify with their family members or other sponsors? And to what extent does USCCB coordinate with other faith-based partners along the migratory route?
Thank you, Gillian. And again, thank you to Georgetown University Collaborative on Global Children's Issues for this opportunity to discuss and hear from others who are also involved in supporting and protecting migrating people. So as you mentioned, USCCB's Department of Migration Refugee Services operates Safe Passages programs, and these are really designed to provide support to youth while they're in federal care and provide a passage for them to life in the community after their time in federal care. So as you mentioned, we are federally funded by the Office of Refugee Resettlement to care for these young people while they're in federal custody and to provide some services after reunification. So some of the support that we provide to these young people in care, you know, I want to definitely highlight that these young people are incredibly resilient, but they also have some unique vulnerabilities that we do need to meet and pay attention to while they're in care. So when they arrive at our programs from the border, they often have little more than the clothes on their back. They don't know where they are. They don't know why they're still in custody. They don't necessarily understand where they're at. So our direct care providers on the ground really seek to welcome them, to meet their basic needs, and to try to make them feel comfortable, safe, and cared for while they are in the program. So we operate a range of providers. We have some small scale shelters, 10 to 24 beds. We have transitional foster care where youth reside with a family within the community while they pursue reunification with a sponsor. We also have long-term foster care for youth without a sponsor, an unaccompanied refugee minor program as well, that provides, again, community-based foster care and a path towards independent living for young people who do receive legal relief. We also provide post-release services to youth who reunify with sponsors and home studies to assess sponsor safety. So while youth are in care at one of our facilities, they receive wraparound services. They receive case management, mental health services, both individually and as a group, multiple times a week, education and preparation for entering into a U.S. classroom. They receive a legal screening and a Know Your Rights presentations that some of our legal service providers support in. They also receive medical and dental care, recreation and leisure services, religious services, some cultural orientation, some things that we take for granted, like riding an escalator, youth may not be familiar with. And so our staff really help young people to learn more about U.S. communities, what life might look like, and how to approach some everyday situations. And then they're also supported in their preparation for the future. And for most youth, this is reunification. And then for some for whom reunification is not an option, we seek permanency through legal relief for them. And again, those without sponsors do go to long-term foster care. These programs support them on this path to permanency, helping them integrate into their communities, helping them pursue their education and build skills that will continue to build on their resiliency and their strengths as they become young adults here in the United States. For those who do have sponsors here in the United States, or those who maybe will choose to return to their country of origin, to return to family members there, the team on the ground works to assess viable sponsors. They work to complete all required paperwork. They conduct interviews with both the children and the potential sponsors and household members. They run background checks and verify documents and really try to involve and update the youth and the sponsors in this process so everybody knows where the case is at and how soon reunification might be able to occur. And our teams really do work to assess the safety and suitability of the placement with the sponsor for these young people, as well as what's in their best interest. They work very closely to prepare the sponsor and the young person for reunification and life together in the community. This can be highlighting resources, which definitely recognizing that doesn't go far enough. They also conduct family sessions to help the young person and the sponsor talk through their relationship, what some of the young person's needs are, what some of the expectations of both the sponsor and the young person will be after reunification. And then for some youth, we also go through a safety planning process as kind of a contingency plan for the youth. And then our Safe Passages programs also conduct home studies to assess a little more closely if there are any particular concerns or vulnerabilities, whether a reunification is in the best interest of the child. And we also provide some post-release services, which I know Matt's going to talk about a little more soon here, so I won't go too deep into that. But these are a key piece in working to ensure the safety of young people. So kind of moving on to our position as a faith-based organization and what our partnership and collaboration looks like. We are a faith-based organization ourselves, and that's kind of the lens that we come through for all of our technical assistance and our training to our network. All of our direct care providers in the Safe Passages program are faith-based organizations as well. We work with Catholic Charities organizations and Bethany Christian Services. And so our providers really seek to integrate faith into the care for these young people and their families by always seeing their dignity as persons, seeing their resiliency and working to meet their needs and support them while they're in care within the context of their strengths. with other faith-based providers. We've had a close working relationship with Lutheran Immigration and Refugee Services, and they provide similar services as we do to migrating youth here in the US. So we've worked together on advocacy, standards of care, best practices. We rely a lot on our local Catholic Charities partners who provide a lot of support and services to newcomer families and young people in local communities. So that's definitely a huge support for these young people after they are reunified. We also recently held a convening for Catholic entities along the southern border in Mexico and in Central American countries. We talked to some bishops' conferences in Mexico and the Guatemalan conference. We've also talked with shelters and organizations in the northern region of Mexico and organizations and shelters in the United States. We actually have frequent communication with Sister Norma, who presented on the last panel. And so the information that our faith partners share really helps us frame our advocacy. It informs us on the impact that various policies have on migrating people, on families and young people in country of origin, as well as on the journey. And it helps raise up the stories of asylum seekers. And some of these anecdotes that were recently shared by our faith partners of some of the concerns for migrating people along the journey raise the dangers of the migrant protection protocols. And we were able to include some of those anecdotes and some of the things that we've learned and seen and our faith partners are seeing in an amicus brief that we submitted to the Supreme Court in the Biden versus Texas case recently. We also regularly participate in the Vatican section on migrants and refugees to help create and support principles for the support of refugees, trafficked persons, migrants, and child refugees and migrants with other lay and clergy leaders across the world to really support people on the move globally. We collaborate with other staff members from various Episcopal conferences, especially their departments that work with people on the move as well. And in the past, we've partnered with other religious and faith-based organizations, particularly in addressing the needs of families who were affected by the zero tolerance policy in 2018. So there we continued our partnerships with Lutheran Immigration Refugee Services, Catholic Charities USA, as well as the local Catholic Charities partners, Islamic Relief USA, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints has been a good partner with us, Bethany Christian Services, and then the Catholic Legal Immigration Network Incorporated Clinic. And of course, we've continued our partnership with various faith-based educational institutes, including Georgetown University. And again, these partnerships really help inform the services that we provide. They help inform our advocacy as we continue to work to support people who are on the move, especially refugee and migrant young people, addressing reforms, policy changes to ensure their protection and well-being. So I'll finish off with a couple of things that we are working on for our advocacy efforts. We continue to work for immigration reform. The migrant protection protocols continue to be very concerning, and we would like to see better protections and pathways for asylum seekers. We advocate for a greater licensed bed capacity to care for unaccompanied children after they come to the United States for trauma-informed and culturally sensitive care. I think none of us want to see the convention centers like we did last year full of young people. So greater licensed bed capacity, long-term solutions for youth without sponsors and better paths to permanency, more robust post-release services for youth who are reunified, and then continued strong policies for youth in federal custody and maintaining existing protections like the Flores settlement, the TVPRA are really key to ensuring protections for these youth. I'll go ahead and wrap up there.
Sorry, I was still muted. Thank you. That was very comprehensive. It's extraordinary to see the range of activities that your team is involved with. And it's been heartening to work directly with some of your partners in local environments too. Thank you so much. Luis, do you want to share your screen? And while you do that, I'm going to ask you a follow-up question, Kathleen. Can you, just for the greater understanding of how long foster care for these children do they tend to be in foster care if they come through your programs? Because I think a lot of our audience may be used to the US foster care system, which is generally longer. So what is the time period
Sure. So the goal, and this is a goal that ORR has put out, is that youth are in care for 30 days, and then they're reunified. They're reunified within 30 days. So I think the average for our network right now is about 36 days for a length of stay. So we do a pretty good job of assessing sponsors quickly, getting youth into communities as quickly as possible. However, I think it is important to put that into the context of safety. We do want youth to go to be reunified as soon as possible, but not at the risk of their safety, not at the risk of what's in their best interest. So again, most youth reunify, I would say, within a week or two. Some kids are reunified like within 10 days. Others have a little bit of a longer stay, especially those who are vulnerable, who maybe don't have a clear sponsor in the US. They may be in care for longer, but about 92% of youth who arrive across the southern border are reunified with a sponsor. And again, the goal is 30 days, though I think the average nationally is a little bit higher right now.
Okay, thank you for that clarification. So that brings us to Matt Haygood, who is the Director of Children's Services for the U.S. Committee for Refugees and Immigrants, USCRI. And you are one of the organizations that also receives federal funding to help some young people access post-release services once they've been reunited with sponsors. So we know that very few, in fact, federal or state dollars are appropriated to help facilitate a local response to newcomer children. And the Migration Policy Institute reports that at least 84% of program costs for unaccompanied migrant children are spent on what is typically the first 30 to 60 days after a child's arrival in the United States, when they're in the custody of the Department of Health and Human Services offices of refugee resettlement. And less than 16% is spent on the following weeks, months, and years when these young people are adjusting to their life in US communities. So as a recipient of federal dollars and working on this small portion of funding that goes to unaccompanied migrant children when they're released to sponsors, can you explain how it works? Who receives post-release services? What do those services entail? And what efforts are underway to ensure that more children can access the support that they need when they get here? Thanks, Matt.
Sure. Thank you, Gillian. Thank you for having me. And it's really an honor to be on this panel with so many other wonderful colleagues, and especially some great organizations that are doing fantastic work. So we really appreciate the opportunity to be to participate on this panel as well. Post-release services, as you said, it is a federally funded program for unaccompanied children who have been released from federal custody. And the main goal of it really is to promote the safety and well-being of unaccompanied children who've been released from federal custody, to make sure that, you know, they're landing well and acclimating well and getting all the supports they need as they are getting used to their new communities. As it stands right now, I would say around 20% of kids actually get post-release services. So 1 in 5 kids are getting those follow-up services, while as the rest are not. And you might ask, well, who are the ones that get those services and how are they determined to be eligible for that? So as it's set up right now, any child who gets a home study, and a home study is basically when there is a more intensive evaluation of a potential home that a kid might be released to, and there's a myriad of reasons why they might get that, but any kid who has received a home study, they're going to get post-release services when they are released. Most frequent, those are survivors of trafficking, a child who's been a victim of abuse or neglect in home country, they have a disability, or there's a particular potential safety concern with the sponsor that they're going to. Other reasons why they might be eligible for post-release services is if they're being released to a sponsor who is unrelated, so maybe a distant relative or family friend, they would automatically be eligible for post-release services. And other reasons might be that anything that they feel like, federal staff feel like a child would benefit from follow-up services. So examples might include if a child is a parent, pregnant or parenting teen, they have mental health concerns, they have significant medical needs, maybe there's a significant trauma history, any myriad of issues that then they can be recommended for and then approved to get post-release services after their release. Now, as you mentioned before, you know, USCRI, we are one of 15 grantees who receive funding to provide these services. And all referrals come directly from the Office of Refugee Resettlement. So these are not referrals that can be made by community-based providers after the fact, and a kid is identified to need some additional supports. All of these referrals are made prior to a child being released. They're not necessarily in place once they're released, but all the referrals come from the Office of Refugee Resettlement. So the way it is structured is essentially it is a brokerage case management model. And if you're not a social worker, that's okay. But the idea is that they are paired with a post-release service worker who help connect them with services and resources in their communities that they might benefit from or they might need so that they can have their needs met and the kid can be successful moving forward. There are different models with different providers. There's not a lot of, I would say, structural federal guidance about how to implement the services. So you have some grantees who have a model of remote staff spread throughout the country in areas where there's kids with higher number of releases. Some have subcontracts or direct offices that have local community presence and are providing the services. And some, like USCRI, we're a bit of both. We have a blend of both partners with community-based organizations as well as staff who are working throughout the country in areas of high need. I would say, with our program in particular, we break it down into sort of three main components. There's a heavy education component, so making sure that sponsors and kids have the information that they need to be successful. So that could include psychoeducation about particular mental health concerns that a child might have, information about local resources, what are the laws, rules, expectations around their immigration proceedings, what to expect as they're going through removal proceedings, what are the expectations and norms in terms of school enrollment and school involvement and attendance and all of those things. We want to provide as much education, and I would say we borrow a little bit from the model of a cultural orientation model on the refugee resettlement side to make sure that everybody has the information that they need to be successful. There is obviously a case management piece, and so there is connecting and making referrals for resources that the family would benefit from or that they're interested in receiving. And we are also very much doing all of this through a child welfare lens. So we are following up to make sure kids are safe. We're doing safety assessments. We're meeting individually with both sponsors and kids to get their perspectives about how things are going and making sure that wherever they are, that kids are safe and that they remain safe. And, if not, we're taking steps to make sure that they are being protected. All of this is done through home visits. We don't necessarily receive clients into an office that they come into. We go out to the home. We're assessing the home to make sure that the kid is placed is safe. We're meeting with family members individually, and we're doing follow-up case management services to make referrals, make sure that they're getting connected. A lot of what we do is helping with school enrollment and navigate that whole process because that can be complicated depending on where someone lives. Obviously trying to get them connected with a legal service provider and any other resources in the community. And for the most cases, this is within a 90-day period. There are cases that are eligible for post-release services until either the kid turns 18 or their immigration proceedings have been completed, but most cases are for around 90 days. So it is a very short time frame, and we've got a lot to do in a short period of time. Part of the, the advocacy that USCRI has been doing along with other organizations for quite some time is that obviously all kids would benefit and should have some type of follow-up services because the transition is just something that is extremely difficult and new, both for the sponsor and household members and for the child who's gone through, this momentous experience coming here into the United States. And so we're lucky and we're happy to hear, at least publicly, the Office of Refugee Resettlement is saying that by the end of 2023, their goal is to have 100% of all children be eligible for post-release services. Now, that does not mean it's going to be consistent the same across all of them because some kids have more or less needs depending on where they're going to. But the idea is that there's going to be three levels of intensity of services going from less intensive to more intensive depending on whatever is going on in that particular case. And we've obviously been a big proponent of that. I should note that while we're excited to see those services expand and eventually that all kids will be eligible, right now there's more than 19,000 children who are eligible. They've been referred for post-release services. They are released. They are out in the community with their sponsors, and they're on a wait list to get those services. So even with the pledge of expanding the services to provide those to all children, there's not enough resources being provided to be able to meet the current need, even though we know that last year was obviously an historic year in terms of the number of kids being released from federal custody. So there's still a lot of advocacy and work that needs to be done and that we're doing to make sure that there is more funding. You know, Gillian, as you mentioned, such a small percentage of funding is provided for sort of once they're released, and so much of it is front loaded. You know, a few years ago, we were looking at the cost of how much it costs to provide those shelter care services to a child versus the follow-up services once they're released. And it costs more in 10 days of housing a child and providing those shelter services than it does to provide 3 months of post-release services. Now, by no means do we advocate that that should replace the safety assessments and, you know, the checks and balances that go into making sure that a child is being released to a safe location. But there is so much more that can be done to make sure that they are safe, that they are taken care of, and that they're landing on their feet and have all the supports that they need once they're in the communities with their family members most of the time. I think another big point that we've recognized and are advocating for is that post-release services can be very beneficial and great when you have a client in a place like Montgomery County. You can refer a child to Identity. You can find a local attorney. They may be eligible and there might be Spanish-speaking resources in the area to provide medical services. Then the connecting of local resources is something that can be easily done and is very beneficial. We are inherently limited in terms of what we can do. When a child, for example, is released to rural Alabama, there's no Spanish-speaking providers. Their immigration court might be 4 hours drive away, and that's where the local immigration attorney is. And so when there are gaps in terms of the local resources, we're inherently limited in terms of what post-release services can do. So while we're glad that there might be more eligibility, that kids would get those services on the back end, one of the things that we're advocating for, and I think a lot of other providers are, is that every kid should be getting legal representation once they're released. We know that is the number one need and focus of a lot of families because they're still going through removal proceedings, and funding attached to being able to represent kids once they're released can go an incredibly long way because their likelihood of being able to remain and obtain some type of legal relief goes up astronomically once they have representation. I think Wendy mentioned this before, but having access to mental health services, again, even in a resource-rich area like the DC, Maryland, Virginia area, there's long wait list of on behavioral health clinics, you know, providing mental health or other behavioral health treatment. So being able to have more direct services provided, not just relying on the local communities, but provided, you know, at the federal level to be able to meet those needs, because it is something that is just, you know, obviously a huge need that they have. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is that post-release services have only been around or federally funded for about a decade, a little bit more than that. You know, it came along with the TVPRA back in 2008, and there hasn't been a lot of research or a lot of funding dedicated to figuring out what is the best model, how does this, you know, what is the best way to approach this, and how can we be most effective with our resources? And instead, you have providers who, you know, like USCCB, like LARS, and ourselves and other people borrowing from the different fields of immigration, from child welfare, but there hasn't been a big focus on the federal level to make sure, okay, are we doing what's most effective and how can we develop best practices? So while we're glad to see that, you know, access is hopefully going to be expanded in the next few years, there's still a lot more work that needs to be done and a lot more that needs to be provided on the back end to make sure that all kids' needs are being met once they're released.
Thank you. Yeah, that's key. And I, Luis, why don't you share your screen and we'll continue to talk. But I appreciate the shout out for the need for research. And I hope that the Georgetown faculty and students tuning in will take up that challenge. There's a lot to do to help these innovators out to make sure that we're innovating based on evidence-based best practices for sure. Thank you. So we're actually a little behind in our schedule. So I'm gonna speed along here. Thank you, Luis. We'll share the images at the end of the series, so you'll all have access to them as he continues to draw afterward. Verena Knaus, thank you for joining us. She is UNICEF's global lead on migration and displacement. And so she has been watching children on the move across the whole world, and as well as along this migration corridor and into the United States, providing child-sensitive and adequate reception and care for the large and growing number of children on the move around the world is a primary concern for UNICEF. And your work brings together the worlds of international child rights and protection and also domestic child welfare. So help us put our US experience, our community-based experience here in a global context. What can we learn from successful approaches to newly arriving migrant and asylum seeking children in other parts of the world? And what do you see happening in the US that might serve as a positive model elsewhere? Thanks for joining us, Farina.
Thank you so much, Gillian. I hope you can all hear me well. And apologies, my screen kept flipping a bit and I may have sort of disappeared into the screen. So I do apologize for that. It's a hard one. I mean, not only the questions are tough, huh? What can we learn from elsewhere? That's an easy one because there are actually a lot of interesting good practices from around the world that I think have direct relevance for the questions that we are discussing here in the US. And obviously there are also a lot of really strong and robust pieces and elements and approaches, as we have just heard. I mean, many of them we've just been hearing about that, you know, are deeply relevant for other countries outside. But it's a hard one to now come after so many strong speakers and to still, you know, keep you to say something new. So let me try to do the following and start off with a bit of a provocative, what's actually at stake here? Why do we need to learn these lessons? And then throw out a few very specific elements that I think probably connect across what previous speakers have already said, what we're doing in, you know, different counties, what we need to do to take into account the specific or different or unique needs of Indigenous children from different groups or different backgrounds. And how do we make sure that whatever we do is actually centered around what children need and not so much centered around what institutions or organizations, including UNICEF and all of us representing an organization here, what we usually do or what we like to do. So if you bear with me, first of all, let me start. Having listened carefully and what also you set us out on in the beginning, Gillian, was I think a basic point that arrivals of children, unaccompanied children included, this is not a sort of a seasonal problem. This is a part of life. And any community, any local authority, any state, any country in the world needs to prepare for a constant flow and ebb of families arriving, fleeing conflict, fleeing violence, or arriving for other reasons, and a large and growing number of unaccompanied children arriving. That's been the trend for the last 20 years. The numbers go up and up and up. And sitting here in Europe and being directly engaged in the Ukraine emergency response, I can tell you, Poland didn't expect that they would be accommodating and hosting and welcoming more than 2 million people today, if you would have asked them back in January. So how do we prepare a country, a system, a national child protection system, an education system, the social welfare service workforce, you know, many of us here today, how are we preparing ourselves for that inevitable moment when we need to trigger into action or already do trigger into action? And I think the one key question that I want to put here is we seem to always be in reactive and emergency mode. Another surge, oh, another flaw, oh, something is happening, we need to scale up. But we don't really, I think, spend enough thought on sort of provoking, thinking, forcing ourselves to just reimagine actually. How could we reimagine reception and care for children? Not from that sort of enforcement, short term, we need to manage a problem, but reimagine it from the perspective of how can we build a reception and care infrastructure that serves children at large? Wherever, whatever the caseload is, yesterday it was children from Guatemala, today it is children from Ukraine, last summer it was children from Afghanistan that needed to step into the same services. How can we reimagine this away from an enforcement approach, away from an approach that distinguishes between federal and what happens at the border to then what happens at the community, that distinguishes between, oh, this is the migration management responsibility and this is where the school, to an approach that actually centers around what these children need. So reimagine, rethink reception and care from the beginning to the end. So if we look around the world and we look at some of the most promising examples where that sort of reimagining is happening and where children have been put more central around designing approaches and policies and investments that go into the child protection system, the social welfare workforce, the school system, and so on, these are the things that we're seeing. Good systems, they are actually putting the child first. They are not thinking about what the institutions need and how do we manage migration and asylum processes. They're saying, what do children need? And how do we make sure that anyone coming into contact with a child actually is equipped and comfortable to consider what the child's best interest could be, what that particular and individual child may need? And that needs to start from border point, the first point of contact, the first person coming into contact, to the very last moment when a child gets released and you sort of close a case and you actually, in the best case scenario, look at a child going their path into adulthood, then into a community and into a life. The second key piece that actually makes a good system is that investments go away from enforcement and border infrastructure and they move and shift towards family and community-based care settings. We're rethinking where we're spending our money. So instead of reinforcing technical surveillance kits and gears and high-tech border infrastructure, we're actually investing money into the soft belly of the system that is so underfunded. And that is the foster care system. It is the social workers. It is the community infrastructure. It's the parent support groups. It's the teacher support that actually makes the journey from a child from point of arrival all the way down to integration to community a smoother and more successful one. And specifically shifting money from federal custody to family and community-based alternative care infrastructure, all the way from small group homes to the foster care family to alternative independent living arrangements for an unaccompanied young adolescent. Third component that is really critical is moving away from designing a system from an adult professional perspective out, like to a moment when we're actually designing it with young people. And I think today's discussion, starting it with the voice of young people, closing it with the voice of young people, forces us to actually be even bolder here. Let's not design a system for young people and children, but with young people and children, and loop them in, make sure that we are constantly course correcting based on their feedback. And then really, most importantly, it's that strong focus that as children get released, and we heard just before from Matt, as children, you know, move out of the system, that we don't just like create a cliffhanger where they drop into an unknown, you know, dark hole, but that the schools are equipped to pick up the work, that the communities are equipped. Now, a few examples where this is working. Now, best interest. How do you get the best interest sort of central to anything, any decision, any moment that a child encounters the child protection or migration or asylum system? First question to ask is, who is in charge? And I think here what we need to flip and what some countries are doing is we need to flip responsibilities. When children are concerned, we need child protection actors in the lead. And if we don't have child protection actors in the lead, then those who are in the lead need to be trained and equipped and have referral protocols that when they are encountering a vulnerable child, and we see this now in the Ukraine response, they know who to call, they know who to refer them to, and we can divert children, not even into a custody system, but already immediately into the protection system. We don't want to get children out of a custody system. We want to avoid them even entering one. So they are coming into contact with child protection professionals, and those are the ones who accompany them. That means we need trained guardians. They play a key role, and we already heard it. And I think here, you asked me, Gillian, is there something that we can learn or that we can take from the US experience? I really do think that the Young Center for Immigrants' Children's Rights work in that area around guardians is a really, really interesting program. And there is other interesting programs like the Netherlands Guardianship Authority that plays a central and key role. Within 24 hours, any unaccompanied child seeking asylum in the Netherlands gets assigned a guardian, the guardian takes charge, they liaise back to the countries of origin, they engage in family assessment, they are working with the child from point of arrival to placement to release and accompanying them. And that is being scaled as we are speaking with the Dutch model on guardianship now becoming the model for European-wide, so 27 member states, guardianship authority, a guardianship network. family community-based care, you know, flipping investments and moving out of an approach that gets children first into sort of short-term holding emergency care into family care. What does that mean? It needs investments. It needs scaling up the infrastructure far away from borders in the communities, foster care, family-based care. And in Greece or in Austria, for example, we've seen massive scale up of independent living options for 15, 16, 17 year olds who arrive, who've been on the road for 2 years, who themselves don't really necessarily want to be with foster families, but they want to be independent, but still supported. So they live with social workers in the community who help them with anything from learning how to cook in their new environment with the food that you can buy, to learning how to prepare for a job interview, to learning the language. So Greece and Austria has some interesting models here where young adults are living together in small apartments with social workers. Child participation, as I said before, is critical. And I think here it is not just a nice to have, it needs to be the must have. We shouldn't make any investment into any program or service that serves children without building in the moment of co-creation on, is this designed with children's needs in mind? How could we continue improving it based on feedback mechanisms and obviously, of course, the complaint mechanisms where things go wrong? And I think here this is, we are still too timid on this, and we can be so much bolder. And I cannot even just fathom how much pain we would reduce and how much money we would save by actually designing processes, procedures, and places where children get housed with young people. And in Germany, for example, you asked me for a model from elsewhere, young people were directly involved in the design of minimum protection standards in reception facilities. It can be done. And last but not least, the role of schools and the sort of what happens post-release. I think schools play such a critical role because that's the place, that's the service platform where mental health, parenting outreach, integration, language support, peer-to-peer connections, where so much more happens than we usually acknowledge. And I think, as we already heard, I think here the public school system in the US is doing fantastic work where they have resources and support, but this is where more support needs to be going, because this is where, you know, children fall off the cliff or where integration takes off. And I think I leave it at this here, and I hope that I recognize a few examples from elsewhere. There's obviously a lot more out there. And the key question that I often hear from US partners is, okay, that's nice in Iceland, but is it scalable in the US context? It is. Obviously, it needs to be contextualized. But the question is really, I think, that mind shift, change, reimagining the way we think about reception and care with a child at the center, with young people as a partner in the design of it, and moving away from a fixation on border infrastructure and large-scale institutional responses to a more agile, more community-based, much more decentralized infrastructure that serves all children and can be equipped and adapted to any child that arrives, no matter where they come from or what the reasons could be for their arrival. Thank you, Gillian.
Thank you too, Verena. That was really stunning. And I feel like you might be fomenting a revolution that I'm quite happy to be a part of. So thank you for the charge. And there's more in the chat. You can see the link to the Building Bridges report, which documents some of those best practices from around the world, in fact. So we have 2 minutes left. And as promised, we are going to end with the voices of young people. So these are three short reflections shared by migrant and asylum seeking youth who recently arrived in Montgomery County. They're actually part of Identities programs. They've shared their stories, but the voices here are those of actors to protect their identity. So we'll close on that note.
Nos mojamos cruzando el río. They put us in a hielera for 4 days. We're still wet. No new clothes. Solo la ropa mojada. They give us aluminum foil to cover ourselves. I try to sleep, but guards wake us up to check our wristbands. Me separan de los pequeños. I was supposed to watch them because I am the oldest, but the little ones get sent back. Su mamá no contesta el teléfono, así que regresan al Salvador. When I come to Maryland, I only have shorts and a light jacket. Está frío. It's snowing. It could have been better if I had food and clothing. right when I left Casa Hogar.
We sleep on the floor, con cobijas de aluminio, 12 hours in a hielera. I know I finally made it when I leave that place. I go to rooms, consigo ropa, pan y zapatos. I finally made it. Voy a la Casa Hogar in Houston. Then in New York, we learn English there. Primero vivo con mi tío, but he doesn't pay me attention, so I go live with mis primos. Identity helps the most. Mi escuela ayuda con la comida. I worry about rent, paying a lawyer. I may need help with talking to someone. A veces me siento muy triste.
I didn't realize that we would be separated. Cuando la inmigración nos atrapó, me separaron de tío y tía. 4 days apart. Después de la hielera, I'm reunited with tío y tía. Then, we come to Maryland. I could use help with school. I could use help learning English. Soon, I want to find work. También quisiera ayuda con eso.